It's a flying car.
Splats and stone chips.
Quad bike.
Attention to detail.
Doing a poo.
First time I have seen this.
Beautiful.
I've never seen one.
Oh!
It's a really eerie time at the moment.
I am in love.
Hi, I'm Adam C and welcome to the glorious grounds of Blenheim Palace, a lineup of four McLaren F1 GTRs, and this is Salon Privé of 2020. So we are starting at this lineup of road legal McLaren F1 GTRs. There's actually another one, another long tail behind us there, and we're going to have a look around at some of the classic cars and brand new hypercars and new releases, world launches around at the show today. So we start the lineup with this glorious Davidoff livery Golf McLaren F1 GTR, and this is indeed road legal. Next along, we've got the Parabolica livery F1 GTR long tail alongside the Lark McLaren F1 GTR, which we have seen at many events before, and the Tag livery beyond that. And as mentioned, this is F1 GTR long tail number 5 on Tom Hartley's stand, which is also road legal. Next door to a McLaren P1 and a LaFerrari. So this section on mainly dealerships. We've got the Furlonger dealership with a Mura, a 250 Lusso, a Bugatti Veyron, a Daytona, and a 275 GTB.
And a moped. That's the most intricately styled moped I have ever seen.
And we next have DK Engineering, who have brought along a fantastic lineup. We've got the new Ford GT, we have a Carrera GT, a Ferrari 288 GTO next door to a Mercedes CLK GTR. The doors are up, so we have a chance to look at that classic 90s interior with the tartan seating. This is number 7 of 25 that were made. Road legal as a homologation for the Le Mans cars in the series. It looks absolutely stunning here next to an F40 of all cars. But there we go, CLK GTR with another 275 short wheelbase and a 250 LM, which has a Dino behind it, and a 275 GTS with another Mura S next to that. And one of the best things about some of these more prestigious events is tucked around the corner we have a Ferrari Monza SP2. Just like no crowds around it, we have the chance to have a proper look around it. I don't think I've seen one of these this close with no crowds before. Obviously this is the SP2, so it has two seats. The SP1 only has the single seat, much like the classic 50s race cars. It's basically a Ferrari F12 underneath, and they are at quite a premium price tag. Oh, there you go, another McLaren F1 just rolling through. And then we go to one of the world premieres of today. This is Touring Superleggera's Aero 3, which originally started life as a Ferrari F12, as you might be able to tell from some of the lines of the car and the triple layer red paint job, but especially the rear end has been completely reimagined. Touring Superleggera actually worked with Ferrari with their first ever car, the Ferrari 166, but this is their own model, a bit of a Grand Tourer, just as crazy as the Ferrari F12 in which it's based with the 6.2-litre V12, but with a completely reworked style, but still bears its original HRE 21-inch wheels. And you may notice behind its very unique rear fin, the Aston Martin section, which has a DB5. This DB5 in particular has been created by Aston Martin Works as a homage to the James Bond Goldfinger example. So it's got the ejector seat sunroof, it's got the shield on the rear, the guns on the front, and the overrider stoppers eject out. Still bears the original BMT 216A number plate from the Bond films. But we've also got the glorious Vanquish Zagato Volante, which is finished in metallic black with various gold details, including the Zagato interior, which looks spectacular. And next along we have the PAL-V, which stands for the Personal Air Land Vehicle. It's a flying car, basically. You need both a pilot's license and a driving license to pilot this vehicle. It's been created by a Dutch company and is on display here at Salon Privé with its propellers retracted in drivable form. So it has three wheels inside the cabin. The steering wheel retracts, and from between your seats you have the joystick for when you want to fly the vehicle.
vehicle.
So it is a gyrocopter, so you'd need to use the rear wheels to accelerate and start the flight, and then the propellers would work the car into the air as it takes flight. And we then come around to this rather phenomenal car. This is the world's fastest accelerating electric car, the Aspark Owl, created by a Japanese company, and is here today at Salon Privé in all its glory with the doors up on display. Let's have a look at the interior. So there it is, and it's full carbon monocoque chassis and carbon fiber body. It produces just shy of 2,000 horsepower. Top speed is 249 miles an hour, which is extremely fast for a full electric car. And 0 to 60 is 1.9 seconds, sub 2 seconds in a car, an electric car. They're making a limited run of 50 of these and are selling them for 2.5 million euros. And next along, beyond this cutesy little MG, we have a very vibrant, well, I want to say car, but this is actually a quad bike. It's registered as a car, but you'll see by the handlebars and the way that you straddle the vehicle, it is a quad bike. This is the world's first super quad. As you can tell by the front and rear lights, R8 underpinnings are present. It's got the Lamborghini Huracan / R8 V10 engine, which produces 850 horsepower, which can get the quad bike up to 217 miles an hour. It has an aluminium frame, a carbon body, and 0 to 60 takes just 2.5 seconds in a vehicle that you are sat on top of rather than inside. Now, for a car, it may look dangerous, but imagine this as a quad bike, a motorbike. It's no more dangerous than your standard superbike. This is a concept, not a production version. The production version will need to have seat belts in it. But could this be the start of a new breed of mobility? And Polestar have brought along both their models, the Model 1 and 2. Next along we have the MAT Stratos. This is a concept version of a new Lancia Stratos. It uses the 4.3-litre V8 from a Scuderia Ferrari. The design was first seen about a decade ago and Ferrari did not consent to its production, but now 25 examples are being made. It makes sense having a Ferrari engine in this because the original Stratos had Ferrari's own Dino V6. Which once again Ferrari were not too happy with Lancia using. But after they were initially skeptical, Ferrari did sign over 500 units of the Dino V6 to Lancia. So this is a similar tale with the 430 Scuderia V8, producing about 540 horsepower. And the value is just about $564,000. Now, MAT are not the only ones here who are bringing back a classic shape. Ayres Design are in front of me, and they have reimagined the Di Tommaso Pantera. They started with a Lamborghini Huracan and built a retro-styled body inspired by Di Tommaso, but in a more modern-day form. So here it is in a gorgeous shade of really dark green. And one very vital design feature that has remained is the pop-up headlights. So this is its UK debut here today. Customers must supply their own Lamborghini donor car first for it then to be transformed into a specification of their desire. And they have also brought along their S1 project, which is a V8 naturally aspirated hypercar with 715 horsepower. And we next come around to McLaren, who have brought along their new Elva, and this is my first time seeing one of these. It's got the same 4-litre twin-turbo V8 as all the other McLarens, but is faster than the track-focused McLaren Senna and has no windscreen. They have also brought along their new McLaren 620R, which is behind the 765 LT, another car I haven't actually seen. And Ferrari have brought along the new SF90 Stradale, another first for me, as well as the 812 GTS and the Ferrari Roma. And Rolls-Royce have brought along the brand new Ghost, which you may notice is completely different in every single way, apart from the Spirited Ecstasy and the umbrellas in the door. Everything else has been changed on the new Rolls-Royce Ghost, including an all-wheel drive system. And next we have Lamborghini, who always put on a show. They've got an Urus, an SVJ, and the new Huracan Evo Spider rear-wheel drive model. In front of them, we've also got the brand new Zenvo tsr-s with fragmented carbon fiber wheels, not forged carbon, fragmented carbon. These are all hand-built. And speaking of carbon fiber, as you look on the front end of the car, you will notice they have constructed the weave in a very unique patterned appearance. Such an extreme attention to detail. And even down the side, it has been crafted to spell out Zenvo in the weave of the carbon fiber. And the weave continues on the interior with a full carbon tub. And as you come around the back of the Zenvo, you have their very famous movable spoiler that adjusts with the corners that you take. And despite its uniqueness in the market, it really does work. It has been trialed and tested by Zenvo for the last 2 years, and it's one of their most unique touches on their cars, as well as the patterned weave in their carbon, which I think is a fantastic touch. Now, there is no supercar show without Bugatti, and they have certainly delivered today. They have the Bugatti Chiron 300, which is the model that reached 300 miles an hour, still with its blemishes, bug splats and stone chips from that famous run. And behind it, we have two world record convertible Vitesses. Next along, we have Bentley, who are flaunting their Mulliner cars. We start with the new Bentley Continental GT Mulliner. Next door to that is something even more special. This is the Bentley Bacalar. They're making 12 of these, all bespoke, and all 12 of them have been sold. Next along, they have their Bentley 4.5-litre blower, which is the car that set the Le Mans lap and won Bentley's fifth win. That is the very car. But the Bentley Mulliner program have taken this very car apart, digitally scanned it, and are making 12 recreations of the Bentley blower. And once again, all 12 have already been sold. And then behind me we have Lotus's brand new electric hypercar, the Avaya. With 2,000 horsepower, it's something for us Brits to be proud of. And inside almost looks like a beehive with the honeycomb effect on the central column, which is continued on the pedal design. Oh look, tyre writing on the tread of the tyres. Then we've got this helicopter, which isn't too sexy. It looks like a fish doing a poo. And next along we have Koenigsegg, who have brought along a Jamera. This is the first time I have seen this, which has been parked next to a Regera. And behind Koenigsegg is a recreation of the XJR13 with the original Jaguar V12. So that was the majority of the manufacturer stands, and as you can probably tell behind me, there is a thick grey cloud, so everyone's going to scramble and cover their cars. So this being a press day, it's also a bit of a setup for everyone else, so cars are being unveiled tomorrow as well as today. We've got cars still turning up. We've got a 365 Boxster Berlin over there, next to one of many Ferrari Dinos that are here today, which has Zach's Garage's Koenigsegg Regera, which is drawing a crowd over there. This is trying to escape them, it seems, as people are running after it. In fact, can we do the same? So Tom Hartley has brought a 488 Pista, a McLaren Senna, a 575 Super America, amongst others, including a P1 and a 918. But here we have the Koenigsegg Regera, carbon blue with gold accents, manoeuvring in front of Blenheim Palace, looking beautiful. We've got these two giants driving a Bugatti and DB5 with a McLaren Senna GTR LM in the Harrods livery and a Zonda in front of the water fountain. Mostly due to my obsession with the McLaren F1 GTRs, I absolutely love the Senna GTR. You can definitely see where the inspiration from the 90s Le Mans cars has come from, with the large rear diffuser, which has been colour-coded in this, the Harrods livery, and the large spoiler and end plates on the rear. It's currently undergoing a bit of a photo shoot with the doors up, displaying the interior. Everyone is flocking to it.
And further on, we have another LaFerrari.
Now, it's certainly got very grey, but I don't think we're going to get any rain. We've got about an hour of the show left, and there's one section that I pretty much saved it for last, because this is exactly the kind of car that I adore. So, we start off with a road-going Ferrari F50. In silver. I've never seen one in this colour. It looks absolutely stunning here, but the rest of the cars are all 90s Le Mans cars. Now, despite absolutely adoring these cars, I don't know as much information as I would love to know about them, but we've got the Ferrari 550 GT1, next door of whom is a Lister Storm. When I was a kid, there was a computer game that had a Lister Storm just like this, in this livery on it, and that is probably what got me into 90s Le Mans cars. I adore the Lister Storm, with its multi-coloured rear end and roof, and next door to him is this Jaguar XJR15. And next to the XJR15 is this silk-cut Jaguar XJR6. What a lineup that is. I mean, we've got more to come, but just now, that is a sight to behold. I am in love with these. Oh, there's another McLaren F1. I knew there was a gap that had been made, so we've got an even bigger lineup of F1s. We've got the red F1, the silver F1, and then the four F1 GTRs with another F1 GTR long tail over there. But with this lineup, we do have a small gap here, and I can hear the distinct rumble of an XJ220 over there, so I'm sure we're going to get some more content in a few seconds. And right on cue is the Jaguar XJ220. This one remarkably has a similar livery to the XJR15. He is taking up this space over here, but I shall probably leave him to it. I don't want to disturb his parking routine, but how's that for a 90s LM/GT1 lineup? Starting with the F50 road car, then XJ220, 550 GT1, Lister Storm, XJR15, and the XJR6. Now, around here we have a few more race cars. A couple of them are unfortunately covered due to the imminent weather. We've got the Peugeot. This one is the 908, and next door to the Peugeot we have an Audi R8 Le Mans car. This is the original R8 before the road car. And fans of Le Mans will know that we have missed out one vital manufacturer from the Le Mans game, and that is Porsche, who have brought this 962C in the Kenwood livery. Porsche are probably my favourite manufacturer to create some spectacular liveried Le Mans cars throughout the years, and this 962C looks stunning at the top of the line with a few Vantage GT4s in front of it, a couple of which are under covers. It's a really eerie time at the moment. We've got a John Player Special McLaren Senna, we've got a 512 BBLM and a Ford GTLM opposite it. I think it's something of a setup day for the remainder of the week for Salon Privé, but it's great to see these cars without a vast crowd around them, because that's what they usually would have. And finally, we finished the day around the other side of Blenheim Palace with another Zenvo just kind of left here. It's rather unusual seeing the lack of crowds, because today is just the press day, but with all of these machines on display for us to drool over. Oh, we've also got... I have now seen a lot of Ferrari Romas. They're all in front of the palace in a lineup ready for presumably test drives. They are competing with the likes of the F-Type and more small-scale Grand Tourers rather than the 812, which is actually a full-blown supercar. And here they are in front of the palace for Salon Privé. There was also a rather gnarly-looking BMW M1 parked here when I came in, which I posted on my Instagram. But I have pretty much concluded the day. I've seen all that I can see, and I'm looking forward to seeing what else Salon Privé has to offer online throughout the other days. So I hope you enjoy that video. Follow me on Instagram for all the highlights and updates and secret behind the scenes photos and whatnot from shows like this that I go to. But for now, thanks for watching.